gonna get this other one. We've been nomadic for a while, so if it's not nailed down, we might move it today. I am so glad to see you. You look so good sitting in their seats. I need just a minute to drink in. We've been looking at your pictures on the back of these pews for so long. I had forgotten what your hair really looked like. Whoo, filling me up, come the Holy Spirit. One of the things we are going to do, and do it right now, is to honor our graduates among us. This is a good year to honor a graduate. For Addison, has it not been incredibly difficult? What a year to be a graduate. What a year. And I know many of our graduates are graduating from college and cannot be with us today. But we are going to celebrate all of them. We have a slide show of them. As soon as it gets up and running, we'll have that running for you. And Addison, I think you might be the only one that is actually live in the flesh today. So I won't pick on you, but I am going to ask you to stand up and come up here with me. I know that's a lot of picking. Granddaughter of Dee Greason. Right there. graduated from Western Carolina University, and she will be working for Mountaintop Golf and Lake Club come the fall. We are proud of all of our graduates. Let's just pause and have a prayer for them. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for the lives of these college and high school graduates. Lord, we have called them by name today because we know that you have once claimed them and continue to hold on to them, sustaining them and strengthening them for this life. We are motivated by the work that they are doing in this world and the grace and the peace that they represent and the ways in which they live their lives. And we ask, O God, that as they move from this place today into the world that is calling their names, that they would remember that they are your children and that they are loved by their church, supported, and encouraged. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Last week, we celebrated Mental Health Sunday. And our Facebook feed was not working very well. So I have asked a couple of those members to come back up, Gloria and Becky, if y'all would just come up. And if there's anybody who did not receive a brochure, a mental health brochure when you first came in, Becky has some more of those that she can hand out to you. As we are preparing to go to God in the spirit of prayer, I wanted to lift up a few prayer concerns to you today, and a prayer praise for sure. Dean Greeson is with us, and so we are so thankful to have your presence with us and give God our great thanksgiving for your healing that you can be with us today. Dean had some surgery last week, and just in a blink of an eye, it seems you are back up on your feet and joining us at church. So we're just so delighted and continue to hope for your healing. Certainly with the Ricky Knowles family this week, are there others that you would have us pray for?
Kristen?
Yes. Amanda's and Rick's nephews,
great nephews,
twins need a little bit of extra nourishment before they can move on to the next phase of their life. All right. Anyone else?
Jim Turner, you put the mother.
Absolutely. Jim, our hearts are with you and Kathy as you celebrate your mom's life this afternoon at 4 o'clock in Thomasville. Sedgefield. Okay. Ricky is in her. Right. Okay. We are with you today, you and your brothers and sisters. Anyone else?
Keep the Tuttle family in prayers, especially Neil.
Neil Tuttle. Let us go to God in the spirit.
God of love, we give thanks for keeping us safe so our church family could be together today to worship in your house. We ask for you to be with us and guide us as we become a wise church. You are always near to us, especially when we are weak, suffering, and vulnerable. Reach out to those who experience mental illness. Lift their burdens, calm their anxiety, and quiet their fears. Surround them with your healing presence, that they may know that they are not alone. We trust that in your time, you would dispel all darkness with your light. May we be reflections of your love in this world. Amen.
Did everyone receive a pamphlet about the WISE program here when you came in? If you did not and you need one, just raise your hand and Becky will bring you one. couple up here, Becky. It's usually the back row folks that give trouble, but today it's the front row folks. All right, our scripture today, we read part of it out in the outside, the great passage of Acts chapter 2, the birth of the church, the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit washed over all who were gathered. There was something else that was happening at Pentecost. Here from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verse 26 and 7, and the 16th chapter, verses 4 through 15. This was Jesus talking to his disciples about how he would not be with them forever, but that he would not leave them orphaned. And he said to them this, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you," Jesus said, "but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. And all that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Your Spirit would fall afresh on each of us in new ways that we can hear, in new ways that we can see, and new ideas that we can do with our hands and our feet. For praying is just the first step of being in the Spirit. So come, Holy Spirit, come. Fall afresh on us. Amen. It was an extraordinary moment. One of those that the Indian writer and activist Roy must have been speaking of when she once said, "Another world is not only possible, She is on her way. Some days I can hear her breathing. Of course, the disciples can't hear or see or imagine anything like that as we find them in this passage in John. It's the last night of Jesus' earthly life. Already he has washed the disciples' feet and served them at the table. He has spoken his last words about his love for them and their charge to love one another in this way. All of his predictions about his death have now come to the surface. His betrayer has left the fold. With the remaining disciples, Jesus has wandered out of the upper room and into the muggy night air. The disciples now understand fully what they had tried to avoid. He is leaving them. Jesus acknowledges it himself, saying multiple times that he is going away to be with the one who sent him. There's no new world to be heard or seen, just so much of the old way things are world, where Rome runs everything, where the power dominates the vulnerable, where those who speak of revolutionary love are crushed by established order, seemingly set against them. Where the only thing that dreamers can see on the horizon is a silhouetted cross. Where the only spark and fire is the torches of the mob who were already on their way to claim him. And yet, it's in this moment, the moment amidst so much evidence of the old and established, this moment so thick and muggy with despair, that Jesus tells them of the Spirit that will come. He speaks of the Advocate, giving them the power to testify. We can't expect someone's cell phone not to go off. For crying out loud, we've been in our jammies watching worship for 14 months. We can't think of those things. Grace abounds. Take your time. All right. The Spirit comes in mysterious ways. So have you ever had an advocate? Maybe you were in the hospital and you couldn't speak for yourself, and someone came to be with you so that when you were hurting too badly to be able to press the button that would give you the morphine, that they would help you, that they would press the call button for the nurse. They were your advocate, seeing that you needed something and helping you get it. Has anybody ever had an advocate? Yeah. I had an advocate one time. I was being kind of bullied in my dance class, and I was sitting outside the door, and after it was over, I never tell mom, I'm telling stories about her, but after it was over, the dance instructor came out to find me. I was with a group of girls that were carpooling together, and he called my name, and I was like, I don't want to go talk to you. Oh, you've been making fun of me. I don't want to face you by myself. And mom had been rearranging the groceries in the back of the car, because that was in the day and age where you went to town from the country, so you made like 12 visits to 12 different places while you're in town. So it was her day to take us to dance class. And so she was rearranging the groceries or doing something in the trunk of the car, and I thought, oh, if ever my mama had heard something behind her back, I hope it's now. And before I knew it, I had an advocate. Somebody standing right by my side, helping me find the words, and when I couldn't, found the words that I needed. I heard them coming out of her mouth. I won't tell you what she said. She always says I embellish stories, so I'll just let her tell you the rest of it. When the Spirit, the Advocate, comes, he will prove the world wrong. Verse 8 says, when the Advocate comes, he will prove the world wrong. They are surrounded by all the things that would prove the world right. The the old stories, the old structures, the loss and defeat, the old rugged cross, and old crooked systems. And Jesus says one is coming who will empower them to prove it all wrong. That's the work of the Spirit, the Advocate, to come and stand next to the one who has been bullied and say to the one who has done the bullying, "That's not right. And I stand because there's power in numbers to make sure that this one is cared for." That's the work of the Spirit. And it's what we see as the Spirit comes and acts in Luke's description of the day of Pentecost. Wind and fire, unrestrained, are falling from the sky and rushing through the streets of Jerusalem. Then suddenly, in a world where everyone is divided in their own private homes and upper rooms, they're spilling into the streets. In a world separated by background and language, suddenly they can understand and communicate. They are not in the streets shouting how different they are, but understanding amidst another their beautiful diversity. In a world of old structures and old stories, Peter stands in the middle of the assembly and declares that "I shall pour out my Spirit on all flesh," says the Lord. And here's what happens when the Spirit pours out. Your sons and your daughters, you know, like the ones who are graduating from high school and college, they will prophesy. And your young shall see visions, and your old will see dreams. Your old will dream dreams. Now, if you're old enough, and I consider myself in this category now, if you're old enough to not be able to sleep through the night for a various a sundry of reasons, you know that this is a big deal to say that your old will dream dreams. You got to be in a deep enough sleep. You've got to be relaxed enough. You've got to be trusting enough in the Spirit to be able to dream dreams. Even those who have seen it all and with their tired eyes and worn imaginations can no longer invest much energy in the notion of something new. When the Spirit comes, they are the very ones who will dream dreams. This is what happened in Indianapolis at the old established church, Broadway United Methodist. Once the largest church in the city, Broadway had dwindled in numbers and involvement since the mid-20th century. And amidst changes in the needs of their neighborhood, they began to respond as other urban churches have, as a caregiver with a food pantry, and after-school programming, a clothes closet, and basic ministries of compassion and charity. But also a decade ago, that began to change, and it was sparked one Pentecost Sunday. Pastor Michael Mather was preaching on Peter's sermon in Acts 2 on this day of Pentecost, "And on all people I will pour out my Spirit. Your young will see visions, your old will dream dreams." And at the community lunch after the service, a woman walked up to him and asked him pointedly, "So how come we don't treat people like that?" Pastor Mike didn't understand. Then the woman explained that she was talking about their food pantry. To get food, people had to fill out a form that basically asked, "How poor are you?" Nowhere on the form did it ask people their gifts. Nowhere did it wonder about their visions and their dreams. Nowhere was there evidence of a belief in God's Spirit working in their lives. If we believe that God's Spirit is flowing down on all people, old and young, women and men, And on the poor, the woman said, why don't we treat people like that's true? The day of Pentecost for Pastor Michael was a turning point. It led him to try to live like he actually believes in the Spirit that brings something new, where we can only see the old structures, the old stories, old habits and patterns and forms. Well, if we want to shake something old, the best way to go through that, or let's say at least an effective way to go through that, is through 14 months of doing something different, isn't it? But in this particular time, it led the church to do away with some of their charity programs and now to ask people with whom they work new questions like, what three things do you do well enough that you could teach someone else how to do it? What three things do you do well enough that you could teach somebody else how to do it? On this particular day, Adele was the one who received this question, and she looked a little troubled, having filled this form out before, and she said, well, I mean, cook. She didn't need job training, come to find out. She knew her gift. So Pastor Mike said, can you cook lunch for our staff? We have a staff meeting tomorrow. Can we hire you to fix lunch for us? It was so delicious that Pastor Mike said, we have a regional meeting next month. Could we hire you to fix lunch for us? They loved it. And then she cooked a church meal and a neighborhood gathering. And then whenever groups asked to use the church, they were encouraged to use Adele. And then they helped her print business cards. And she passed them out anytime her food was served. And within 18 months from the time she filled out that new form for some food assistance and said she could cook, she had opened her own business called Adele's Fajita Shop, which remains a popular lunch spot to this day. Because a church, a gathered community of those on whom the Spirit had fallen, right in the middle of so many old stories, patterns, and ways, was able to see new visions. Just one question is all it took. From that new vision and that new dream, it taught people how to feel the Spirit and that the Spirit had come down on them. Just think of what this could mean in a world where so many of the disciples huddled together in places of defeat, them and us. So many are trapped in that upper room where so often we find ourselves unable to see, too tired to dream dreams, too jaded and hardened to imagine anything more than this, as the old ways just prove the world right. Someone once said, giving a stirring sermon on the Spirit and its ability to enliven and inspire us to change the world. At the close of the service, a dear parishioner was in the greeting line and nodded knowingly, patted him on the arm, this preacher who had poured out his own Spirit on Pentecost. And the parishioner said, if only it were true, if only it were true. Just think of what it could mean, Pentecostal church. If we really believed that the Spirit was poured out on us, on me and you and you and you and even me. The Spirit said, Jesus said as the Spirit was coming, I have gone away, but the Spirit I have sent to you so that you can dream dreams and see visions. And we know the truth of Pentecost, that it happens right in the old places, the places where we would never expect it to happen. So the world nods knowingly, pats our arms, and says, nice idea, but things don't ever change. If only it were true. But Jesus says, I have sent you the Spirit. It was Pentecost Sunday years ago when Pastor Tom Long, preacher and professor, was a young pastor serving his first church, and he decided to do a children's sermon. And so calling the children forward, he asked them if they knew what Pentecost was all about. But all the kids gave him was stone silence. And so he told them the story of Pentecost, sharing about the great rush of wind, the flames descending upon the people so that they could hear and understand the words spoken in their own language, holding the children's attention with his dramatic flair. He described how the disciples went from there with the power of the Spirit and began healing the sick and selling their possessions to provide for all in need, began raising people up from the dead, doing the very work of Jesus, how they began changing the world, and their eyes were wide with amazement, these children. And finally, one little girl raised her hand and said, excuse me, Reverend Long, but when was this? I think my family must have been absent for this Sunday. And the amazing thing about that story is that in her imagination, the little girl believed that could actually happen in her church. That her church could be the place where the Spirit came. That her church could be the place where the Spirit rested on all of us. That her church could be the place where people believed it, where people dreamed it, and where they knew the Spirit that recreates us and proves this old world wrong. She could feel it, and she could see it. It's Pentecost. The Advocate comes to stand with us, to say the words that we cannot begin to find, to do the work that we do not know how to start, to complete something that we do not know how to finish. Oh, church, can we dream dreams? Can we see visions? You haven't missed it. It's happening right now in this church.
It is happening. As we gather around the table to eat a meal together, we're going to take this meal and we're going to go outside and finish where we can feel the Spirit and the wind in our hair and know what it is like to be a part of God's creation on Pentecost. So around this table, as we pull up our chair, to know that every one of us are invited. Everyone. You don't have to worry if you've been good enough this week. This is not the Santa Claus list. You are invited because you are you. You are invited because you, your face, your life, your fingerprint, the places where you have walked, you are created in the image of God. And that is all you need to gather around this table, to know of God's grace, to experience God's mercy, and to be about the business of forgiveness in a world that needs it now more than ever. So we remember on that day, on that night when Jesus gathered around the table with his disciples and he broke the bread and he ate with them. And he said, this is my body broken for you. Remember my love for you. And on that same night, he took the cup and he poured it, and he offered it around the table to his disciples, the same disciples whom he had washed feet. And around that table for his friends and the ones he knew would betray him, he offered them the cup of forgiveness. This is the cup of the new covenant. I have poured out myself for you that you may remember and do likewise in your ministry. The table has been set. The roll has already been made, and you are on it. Come, for all things are now ready. The way communion will work here today is that you come forward, and I will hand you your communion in a bag, and we will take it outside to eat together, to celebrate this extraordinary meal made out of common elements. So let us pray and bless this food. Almighty and most gracious God, we come not because we are perfect, but precisely because we are not. We ask, O God, that you would help us believe in our hearts and in our minds, and in the very fibers of our being, that we are welcome at this table in your presence, that you receive us just as we are, and you encourage us to continue to follow in the ways of the Spirit, to dream dreams, and to know of your vision for this world. Bless this meal, this bread, this grain of the field, and this juice, the fruit of the vine, reminding us that you nurture us and help us grow, and that in so doing, we know of your love, your mercy, and your grace. May this meal fill us, fill our bellies and our souls, that we would taste the bitterness and the sweetness of your gift and allow it to seep into our lives. Amen. The giving boxes, if you are feeling inclined to share your resources, is at the doorway going out. We will come forward, receive communion, and then leave out the side door, and we will meet back at the front of the church where we started this morning. If mobility keeps you from making this path, please let us know and we will assist you.
Spring, as the kite on our string. I'm so sorry I walked in front of you.
You're fine. You're fine.